This week on Jerusalem Dateline, the story of modern Israel as told through the camera of one prize-winning photographer. Plus, Egypt on the edge, the military cracks down on the Muslim Brotherhood, and the country's Christians are caught in the middle. And technology brings ancient biblical faces to life. You have to see it to believe it. Hello and welcome to this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. I'm Chris Mitchell. This year, the modern state of Israel turns 65 years old. Since its founding in 1948, few people have witnessed the entire span of Israel's tumultuous history. But one man has not only witnessed it, he's captured that history with a camera. More than 60 years ago, Israeli photojournalist David Rubinger began his career, just before the birth of the State of Israel.
That gave me a chance that very few photographers have to really cover a story, which an entire story from A to Z.
Rubinger tells his story and Israel's in a book called Israel Through My Lens. He documented those early historic days, like the day in 1947 when the UN voted for the establishment of a Jewish state.
People were dancing in the street. The young kids on the morrow of the UN decision to establish the state of Israel climbed aboard a British armored car with the British police numbers on it and the British driver and with a hand-painted flag.
He began as a freelance cameraman and later worked for years as Time Life's photographer. He showed Israel's first years, its fight for independence, and the joy of Jews returning to the promised land from all over the world.
The idealism, the feeling, the striving for equality, social justice, ashamed not to work.
During his career, he's photographed nearly all of Israel's leaders, from Jerusalem's legendary mayor, Teddy Kollek, to its future Prime Minister, Shimon Peres, Prime Minister Golda Meir at the Knesset and in her kitchen, Yitzhak Rabin and his wife, Leah, having breakfast, then Israeli generals Rabin and Moshe Dayan during wartime. And of course, Israel's first Prime Minister, David Ben-Gurion.
His face was something. I have it on the cover of one of my books. It's like granite, strong like a rock.
He's covered Israel's triumphs, capturing the jubilation after the successful raid on Entebbe. He showed Israel's suffering through its many wars.
One of my dearest pictures is one of taken in Aswan in 1980. Very, very intimate pose between two leaders after four wars. And such intimacy.
But Rubinger's most famous photograph came during the 1967 Six-Day War. For the first time in nearly 2,500 years, Israeli paratroopers captured Jerusalem's Old City and the famous Western Wall. The paratroopers came to the wall, and Rubinger was there.
In order to get any little bit of perspective, I wanted to shoot from below, and I was lying on the ground and shooting, and these three soldiers just walked by. I got three frames, nearly identical.
Years later, Rubinger photographed those same three paratroopers back at the Western Wall. The men and their country have grown up.
Grown up is the word. Gone is the beauty of childhood, the idealism of youth.
Since 1967, Rubinger feels Israel has made unwise decisions. He's very critical of many of its policies. But as the nation celebrates one more anniversary, he says it's been a remarkable history.
I think it's unprecedented in history that people did in 60 years what this country did in 60 years.
If you want to see more of David Rubinger's images, you can look at our Jerusalem Dateline page at cbnnews.com. There you'll find a link to his pictures. In Egypt, the military's crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood left more than 1,000 people dead and a backlash against the Christian community. That story leads our weekly news wrap-up.
Thanks, Chris. Hello, everyone. I'm George Thomas. The crisis in Egypt is far from over. The military has arrested most of the top leaders of the Muslim Brotherhood. Meanwhile, Christians are still laying low after radical Islamists attacked their homes, businesses, and churches.
Scenes like this of churches burning across Egypt should have never happened. Amnesty International is accusing security forces of a shocking dereliction of duty in protecting Christians. The backlash against Coptic Christians should have been anticipated, Amnesty said in a statement. In the current political standoff, both the Egyptian authorities and the leadership of the Muslim Brotherhood have shamefully failed to prevent and stop attacks on Coptic Christians. At least 60 churches were destroyed, along with Christian schools, homes, and businesses. The army escalated their crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood by arresting its top spiritual advisor, Mohammed Bodi, for incitement to murder. The group said his arrest was just one Brotherhood member.
He is of huge value for us. We are in pain. But the Brotherhood operates as a coalition on all levels of society, and his arrest will not affect our operations.
But it has so far, with the Brotherhood's most experienced and respected leaders now behind bars.
Thank God that Mohammed Badia has been arrested, and the government should take all the necessary measures for the Brotherhood to stop.
Meanwhile, the White House is disputing a report that the U.S. has already cut military aid to Egypt, saying events in the country are still unfolding.
That aid that we have provided in the past, or the aid that's in the pipeline for us to provide moving forward, is something that is under review.
Meanwhile, Christians worldwide are urging prayer for Egypt's Christian community and for world leaders to call for an end to the attacks on churches. Here in the United States, hundreds of Egyptian protesters rallied in front of the White House, outraged over President Obama's support for the Muslim Brotherhood. Coptic Christians and moderate Muslims say the United States has backed the wrong side in Egypt. They're also blasting the news media's bias in favor of the Brotherhood. Mark Martin has more.
Don't support terrorists. Don't support terrorists. Please, Mr. Obama, I voted for you. Don't support terrorists.
Hala Salem was one of hundreds of protesters in Washington, D.C. Thursday, demanding President Obama stop supporting the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. They first gathered in front of the White House.
He's asking us, the Egyptian, to leave the terrorists in Egypt alone, to kill us, to kill our people. It's not going to happen.
Christians and Muslims gathered together in opposition against the Brotherhood.
I'm a Muslim. It's not a Christian thing. It's an Egyptian thing.
They are terrorists. They have done so many problems in Egypt.
There are new concerns the old regime is making a comeback, as former Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak was released from prison and flown to a military hospital. He is under house arrest. But protesters here say Mubarak wasn't as bad as ousted President Mohamed Morsi.
He's not really a good guy, but he's not at least a terrorist. But Mohamed Morsi is a terrorist. He belongs to the Muslim Brotherhood.
The protesters say the Egyptian military is needed to keep order.
He protects us from a Muslim Brotherhood. Muslim Brotherhood kill us, kill all Christian people.
Those at the rally say the Brotherhood has burned dozens of Christian churches, businesses, and more.
For the Coptic Christian, they burn their houses.
They're targeting them.
And these protesters are also angered by the coverage of the situation in Egypt by Western media. They rallied against the Washington Post, accusing both the newspaper and President Obama of being biased in favor of the Muslim Brotherhood.
So Obama administration helps the Brotherhood right now in Egypt. That is not right. That has a lot of question marks. Why? Why?
Mark Martin, CBN News.
And those are important questions. Israel's Counterterrorism Bureau is warning of a plot to hit Israeli and Jewish targets worldwide in the coming weeks. Dozens of countries were listed as having concrete indications of a terrorist threat. There's concern that terror attacks will be timed to coincide with upcoming Jewish holidays like Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, as well as the anniversary of the 9/11 terror attacks. The Bureau says Israeli businessmen and ex-government officials are prime targets for assassination or kidnapping. Israelis and Palestinians are in the midst of another round of peace talks. Israel released 24 Palestinian terrorists as a precondition to restarting those talks. Among those freed, the murder of an American citizen. Now, some are calling for the United States to pursue justice. Julie Stahl has that story.
Israel released 26 Palestinian terrorists as a gesture to the Palestinian Authority. Among them, Mustafa al-Hajj, who stabbed a U.S. citizen to death.
Zionist Organization of America is particularly concerned about, let's say, the family of Freddie Rosenfeld, who was killed in 1989 by Palestinian terrorists. One of his two killers was released as part of this first batch.
Jeff Daub heads the ZOA offices in Israel. He says he wants to see American laws upheld and justice served.
There are a number of laws that explicitly calls upon the U.S. government to pursue, to capture, to bring to justice, if need be, extradite terrorists or murderers of American citizens overseas.
Daub says the FBI has never initiated an investigation of Americans killed by Palestinian terrorists. He says many Israelis are upset about the release.
They thought that justice was being served, but somehow it has escaped them. This is not something, as far as most Israelis are concerned, that should be needed in order to bring the other party to the negotiating table.
House Majority Leader Eric Cantor is leading a delegation of Republican congressmen on a fact-finding mission to Israel. He said freeing terrorists was a difficult decision for Israel to make.
It is inconceivable, I think, that any other government would be expected to do something like that. I think it underscores the need for a cultural shift on the part of the Palestinians when we see them celebrating in the streets of Ramallah and elsewhere on the release of terrorists with bloods on their hands.
Cantor is no stranger to terror. His 16-year-old nephew, American Daniel Woltz, was killed along with 10 others in a suicide bombing in Tel Aviv in 2006.
That is the problem, I believe, in the whole prospects for peace here in this region. There has to be a willingness on the part of both sides to respect one another's right to exist.
Julie Stahl, CBN News, Jerusalem.
And coming up, the future of Egypt. Will the Muslim Brotherhood go quietly, or will there be civil war? And who will protect the country's Christians? Our reporter Roundtable takes on those tough questions.
Today we're on a field trip to discover what inflation is doing to our paper money. In this hand is a $20 bill and in this hand is a $20 US gold coin. They used to have the same buying power, but how much can they buy today? In this first basket is what my $20 bill buys. Milk, bread, peanut butter, and jelly. And here's what one $20 gold coin will buy. Six baskets full, worth nearly $2,000, almost 100 times more food, simply by owning gold dollars instead of paper dollars. History shows that the gold coins have been the best way to beat the rising cost of living. So class, the moral is that unless you want to live on peanut butter and jelly sandwiches in the future, you should turn some paper dollars into gold coins now. How and why is explained in a new book, The Great Debasement. Call the number below for a totally free copy. And that's the simple truth.
Help! If an emergency happened right now, you can have help at the push of a button with Medical Alert.
Remember when I took that fall, Mary?
Oh, yes, that was terrible.
Yes, it was.
Help!
And I thought, what if you hadn't been there? I ordered my Medical Alert the next day.
I can't describe how safe I feel now with my Medical Alert. You didn't know I was wearing it, did you?
Medical Alert is easy to install, waterproof, and covers you inside your home and out.
It helps me feel safe from fires, break-ins.
And of course, a Medical Alert. And if you don't have a home phone, don't worry. They have that covered.
There's always help at the push of a button. Don't wait till you need it.
Get Medical Alert for less than a dollar a day. There are no long-term contracts. Order now and get your second button free. Call for your free brochure.
For your free Medical Alert system with second button free, call 800-575-8507.
Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. Will the Muslim Brotherhood go quietly, or will there be more violence in Egypt, particularly against the country's Christians? Joining me to discuss these questions and more is CBN international correspondent Gary Lane and CBN News terrorism analyst Eric Steckelbeck, whose latest book is a timely one called The Brotherhood, America's Next Great Enemy. Gary, the numbers coming out of Egypt are staggering. One church hasn't canceled mass for the first time in 1,600 years. How bad is the situation in Egypt, and how are the Christians responding?
We are receiving some reports in villages around Luxor where they're staying inside, and some of them are going hungry. There's not enough food there. Also, some Christians in places like Minya have canceled those services, as you had mentioned, and they're lying low. Many are afraid now of what may come next.
Do we know that it was the Muslim Brotherhood that were involved in these attacks, or other Salafists and other Egyptians?
Well, it's for the most part, Chris, it's a combination. But yes, Brotherhood members were involved. There are people who have witnessed known Brotherhood members in their villages attacking the churches, others that are known as Salafists attacking the churches, and then the Muslim Brotherhood itself. On its Freedom and Justice Party, that's the political wing of the Muslim Brotherhood, on that website, the Facebook site of the Freedom and Justice Party, they had said burning churches is justified.
Eric, you've been studying the Brotherhood for a long time, and your book is quite a timely one. Do you think Egypt's going to try to ban the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt?
You know, Chris, I think there is a very good chance that the Egyptian military, the ruling regime now, will try to ban the Brotherhood. Look, the Brotherhood has been a cancer in that country, Chris, for close to 90 years now. Jihad, assassinations, propaganda against the Egyptian regime. But I have to stress that the Brotherhood has been down this road before, Chris. Back in the early 1950s, the Egyptian military regime then, under Nasser, banned the Brotherhood, burnt their headquarters to the ground in Cairo, executed, arrested several top Brotherhood leaders. Yet the Brotherhood was resilient. They were able to come all the way back by the year 2012 and actually win the Egyptian presidency. So the Brotherhood will not go quietly, Chris. Their MO for the past eight decades has been jihad and violence.
I was down in Egypt just a few weeks ago, and one of the things that Egyptians were telling me is that they were astounded that the United States, they felt, was supporting the Brotherhood.
It was so disheartening to me, Chris, a few weeks ago to see millions of Egyptians in Tahrir Square protesting against the jihadist Muslim Brotherhood and holding signs against America, against President Obama, saying he's a friend of the Muslim Brotherhood, a friend of terrorism. Chris, to side with this organization, the Muslim Brotherhood, it's astounding. This is the granddaddy of all modern Islamic terrorist groups. They spawned Al-Qaeda. They spawned Hamas. Look, the Egyptian military are no saints, but in this situation, in my opinion, we should be supporting the Egyptian military in its efforts to crush the Muslim Brotherhood.
Gary, you've been to Egypt many times. You did an excellent story just a few days ago about Christian girls being kidnapped by a Muslim extremist. Describe what it's like for the Christians there and tell us how we can support them and pray for them.
Chris, they're under constant pressure. Many, once they become young teens and into their older teen years, are kidnapped by Muslim boys, forced to convert to Islam. In some cases, they are raped. And as you know, in Egyptian society, that's very shameful. Did that happen? If that happens to your family, bring shame on your family. And so then they marry and they convert to Islam, not
exactly
necessarily willingly.
Yeah. Eric, last question to you. Where do you think this goes from here?
In my study of them, Chris, they operate most effectively when they have a grievance against Israel, against the Egyptian military, against America. Now they will really rally the troops. They'll say, hey, we tried democracy, we won, and then it was wrenched away from us. Why should the Brotherhood now, after what went down with Morsi, why should they participate again in the political process? There's a good chance, Chris, they will return to their roots and return to violence. Keep an eye on the Suez Canal, Chris. A lot of the world's oil passes through there every day on its way to America, Europe. If that becomes a terror target, we're all going to feel it.
Gary Lane and Eric Seckelbeck, thanks for your analysis and insight. And thanks for being with us on Jerusalem Dateline.
Up next, are these the faces of people from biblical times? How new technology is adding flesh and bones to archaeology.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
Welcome back to Jerusalem Dateline. Have you ever wondered what Samson's Delilah looked like? Or a man who might have known Jesus? Science and technology are teaming up now to give us a glimpse of the people from the time of the Bible.
This is the skull of a man who lived in Galilee during the time of Jesus and might actually have heard his sermon on the Mount. This was a Philistine woman who may have known Delilah from the time of Samson. And this is how they could have looked. They appeared in the National Geographic documentaries, Lost Faces of the Bible.
You do see facial reconstructions of ancient people, Iceman from Europe or Egyptian mummies, but you never see biblical faces. You never see people from the Holy Land, from Israel.
When human bones are found in Israel, Jewish religious activists usually insist they be reburied immediately. So to work with skulls is rare.
We realize that modern technology has given us an opportunity to do in Israel what has been done elsewhere, namely to bring ancient faces back to life.
Using criminal investigation techniques, filmmaker Simcha Jacobovici, anthropologist Israel Hershkovitz, and their team reconstructed four ancient faces to flesh out stories from the Bible.
They want to tell the story of the Jewish people in the Galilee. So, and I use it, and I use the facial reconstruction to look at the story and from a different angle.
The other players, a Canaanite baby placed in a jar and buried under a house, might have been a child sacrifice. And a 6,000-year-old hunter shows life from the world of Jacob and Esau, or Cain and Abel. Experts began by loading a CAT scan of the real skulls into a computer. An artist fills in any postmortem damage, like this missing eye socket. A 3D copier prints layers of the digital image as glue on successive layers of fine powder. Forensic artist Victoria Lywood gives the skull cast a face. What comes out is amazing.
So essentially what you're doing is you're going feature by feature and developing each one of those according to the studies, and then what you get at the end of it is an approximation of the person you're after.
Lywood says she doesn't anticipate the way the face will look.
You just work it and you see what you get at the end of it. And I was surprised when I saw the man who knew Jesus. I thought, you know, let me check my measurements because this kind of looks like something that you would see maybe from the Bible or something like this.
At the same time, another forensic artist worked on a digital reconstruction, much the same as animation is done today. His man from Galilee was similar, but different. Hershkovitz says he hopes these reconstructions will help young people understand the value of history.
If you want to have a future, a better future, we have to learn more about the past.
I'm hoping that through the vehicle of this modern CSI type forensic reconstruction, people will actually get excited again about turning to the Bible and reading these stories that are really the lifeblood of Western civilization.
Coming up, it's an opera written and performed by children, but it has a dark history. How this woman is making sure these kids learn the truth behind Bundabar.
When you're driving along and your cell phone rings, do your eyes instantly go off the road?
then you need to get a grip. Hi, David Jones here with the new GripGo, the most versatile hands-free mount that will instantly grip any phone for safe driving. Just attach the suction cup to your windshield or dash, and GripGo grabs your phone ultra fast. That it peels right off. And don't worry, there's no sticky residue left behind. The 360-degree pivoting mount allows you to always get the perfect viewing angle. It's even strong enough to grab and hold this expensive smartphone out the window, yet it comes right off with ease. That's the advantage of GripGo. You can get the amazing GripGo with dashboard mount for only $14.95. We'll send you a second kit free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Get two complete GripGo systems for just $14.95.
To order GripGo for $14.95 plus processing and handling, call 1-800-709-5259 or order online at getgripgo.com.
Jim is 38, mortgage, married, three great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? $60? $40? Actually, none of the above. Jim can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $19 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll comparison shop the pick of insurance companies like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. Jim's wife, Deidre, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or go to SelectQuote.com. SelectQuote. We shop, you save.
Finally today, one Holocaust survivor is helping a new generation understand what happened when she was a child in Nazi Germany. Mark Martin has the story of one woman who's making sure that history is not forgotten.
The opera Brundibar was written for and performed by children. But behind the bright voices lies a dark history. Brundibar was first performed by Jewish children imprisoned in the Terezin concentration camp in Czechoslovakia. One performance was staged for Red Cross inspectors and filmed by the Nazis. The children were later moved to Auschwitz, where they were killed. Ella Weisberger was among the few survivors. She played the role of the cat in the Terezin performance. She now travels wherever Brundibar is performed, explaining how history survives through the music and telling the story of her friends.
This little opera will never die, and you are part of it.
The children of LA Opera Camp say that performing Brundibar has been about so much more than just learning a children's opera.
It's amazing to get inside history like that. You don't normally get that kind of opportunity when you're just studying the Holocaust in school.
Before learning the songs, children learned the history of the children who originally sang them.
Every kid in Los Angeles, in our country, ought to know this story.
More than 50 children from the Los Angeles area spend 2 weeks every summer in opera camp. Mark Martin, CBN News.
That's it for this edition of Jerusalem Dateline. Thanks for joining us. I'm Chris Mitchell. We'll see you next time, right here in Jerusalem.